receive at least $100 billion in investments during President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s trilateral summit with the U.S. and Japan.
Another arrest warrant out for televangelist Apollo Quiboloy for human trafficking.
The Philippines' unemployment and underemployment rates fall in February.
And the Asian Development Bank lowers its economic growth forecast for the Philippines, citing sticky inflation.
Good afternoon, I'm Ron Crow.
And I'm Denise Insai.
You're watching Top Story. The Philippines expected to receive at least $100 billion in investments from the U.S. and Japan in the next 5 to 10 years. This is according to Manila's envoy to Washington, Jose Manuel Romualdez, who says the investments will cover the energy, semiconductor, cybersecurity sectors, among others. The investment package is one of the projects expected to be announced during President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s first-of-a-kind trilateral meeting with his U.S. and Japanese counterparts in Washington later today, Thursday. Marcos is already in Washington for the summit. Despite the show of force from the three allies, Romualdez insists that the three are not looking to provoke any country.
We know clearly what we want to do, which is to protect our territory and our sovereign rights. And so all of these things that we're doing is precisely in that direction. For so many years, the Filipino patience has been stretched to the limit. And we are now at the point where, are we just going to sit and see our fishermen suffer? We just want to be given our right to be able to explore our own environment, our territory, the respect for international law.
Meanwhile, U.S. National Security Communications Advisor John Kirby says there's no reason for China to, quote, overreact to the multilateral strategies happening in the region, specifically the recent quadrilateral exercises involving the Philippines, Australia, Japan, and the U.S.
This is about freedom of navigation. It's about adherence to international law. It's about proving the simple point that we and our allies will fly, sail, and operate wherever international law permits us to do. And it does in the South China Sea, and we did.
Now, on the eve of the trilateral summit, two U.S. senators introduced a bipartisan bill to provide Manila with $2.5 billion to boost its defense against Chinese pressure. The bill was put forward by Republican Bill Hagerty and Democrat Tim Kaine. It authorizes $500 million a year in foreign military financing to the Philippines over 5 years or until 2029. It seeks to help modernize Manila's defense capabilities, including coastal, air, and land defense, maritime security, intelligence, and defensive cybersecurity. Senators Hagerty and Kaine said it is critical to deepen cooperation with the Philippines and provide it with support in the face of China's growing aggression in the West Philippine Sea.
China asserts there's never been any problem with the freedom of navigation in the South China Sea. That statement coming from Chinese Foreign Ministry spokesperson Mao Ning in reaction to the upcoming trilateral summit in Washington.
Thanks to the joint efforts of China and ASEAN, the South China Sea has basically maintained peace and stability. Some countries outside the region, led by the United States, are constantly forming small circles in the South China Sea to engage in confrontation in the name of cooperation, flex their muscles in the name of peace, and create chaos in the name of order.
Beijing claims sovereignty over nearly the entire South China Sea. Chinese Coast Guard vessels and maritime militias have regularly harassed Filipino fishermen away from their traditional fishing spots, including aggressive actions against Manila's resupply missions in the West Philippine Sea.
U.S. President Joe Biden and Japanese Prime Minister Fumio Kishida boosting their country's defense cooperation in a move that's seen to counter China and Russia. America and its allies have been bolstering their militaries amid a growing threat from China and to deter any attempt to seize Taiwan, which Beijing claims as its own. Biden said U.S. and Japan militaries will cooperate with a joint command structure. They will also develop a new air missile defense network together with Australia. During a lavish state dinner, Biden and Kishida said their alliance is stronger than ever.
We are the same, Japan and the United States. We may be divided by distance, but the generations after generation, we've been brought together the same hopes, the same values, the same commitment to democracy and freedom, and to dignity for all. And today, without question, our alliance is literally stronger than it has ever been.
Japan and the United States are united than ever before. I believe that the Pacific Ocean has brought Japan and the United States together and so close because of the pioneering spirit of those who came before us and frontier spirit that we all have in common.
The Chinese embassy slams accusations of so-called sleeper cells threatening Philippine national security. In a statement, the embassy called the allegations malicious and groundless. It reiterated the so-called sleeper cells are nothing but fabrications that create tensions in Beijing's long-standing friendship with Manila. The embassy also urged the Philippines to stop spinning false narratives and arousing anti-China sentiments. Four Chinese nationals were earlier arrested in Palawan province for issuing fraudulently acquired Philippine identification cards, such as passports, with special resident retiree visas.
Other news, another arrest warrant issued against fugitive televangelist Apolo Quiboloy. The Pasig Regional Trial Court ordered Quiboloy's arrest for qualified human trafficking, which is a non-bailable case. The court also denied the motion of Quiboloy's camp to defer the proceedings. The Kingdom of Jesus Christ leader has been in hiding since a Davao court ordered his arrest on charges of sexual abuse of minors. Quiboloy's legal team has since moved to get rid of that warrant against him.
He has still remedies under the law. If the warrant of arrest would be rendered void because the information is void, because the resolution is void, why is it void? Because it violated his right to speedy disposition of cases. So there is no arrest against him. He cannot be classified fully yet as a fugitive from justice because the charge against him is still under question.
Justice Secretary Jesus Crispin Rimulya welcomes a Pasig court's arrest order against Quiboloy. In a statement, he says it shows the Philippine criminal justice system is efficient. Rimulya adds this is proof the government is bent on holding to account persons who violate the law regardless of their standing in society.
Former Health Secretary Jeanette Garin and other co-accused attend the first day of the trial for the controversial purchase of the anti-dengue vaccine, Dengvaxia. Our correspondent Victoria Tulad now on the line with the details. Victoria?
Denise, former Department of Health Secretary and current Iloilo Representative Jeanette Loreto Garin personally attended the first day of the Sandigan Bayan's trial proper of her graft and illegal use of public funds cases in connection with the purchase of the anti-dengue vaccine Dengvaxia. Also in attendance were other co-accused, former DOH undersecretaries Gerardo Bayugo and Kenneth Hartigan Go, former DOH officer in charge, Director Maria Joyce Ducusin, and former Philippine Children's Medical Center Executive Director Julius Lechones. The five have been charged with allegedly realigning 3.5 billion pesos in government fund to procure the said vaccines in 2015 for the immunization of school children. During the hearing of the Sandigan Bayan 2nd Division earlier today, the prosecution presented Gerona Silagan, Administrator Officer 3 of PCMC, and Corazon de la Cruz, Information Officer 3 of DOH Central Office. Silagan certified that the documents she submitted to the prosecutors were certified true copies. It was not mentioned during the hearing what these documents were. De La Cruz was presented to testify on documents submitted by her office, but she was not questioned. It was also not explained what these files were. The hearing ended after the two witnesses took the stand. The next hearing is scheduled on May 2. It can be recalled that in January, the anti-graft court denied the motion to quash of Garin and her co-accused. They argued that the facts against them did not constitute an offense and that their right to speedy disposition of cases was violated because of supposed inordinate delay. A complaint was filed before the ombudsman on February 2015, but charges were filed in the Sandigan Bayan only on October 2023. The court said, however, that the allegations are sufficient and that the length of time it took for charges to be filed only meant that a careful examination was undertaken. Many claimed that some children died after receiving the vaccine. Denise?
Thanks for that, Victoria.
President Marcos tightens the issuance of protocol license plates to government officials. Marcos signed an order cutting the number of low-numbered protocol license plates from 16 to 14. The plates are only valid during the official's incumbency and can only be used on vehicles duly registered to their name or officially assigned to them. The order comes following the unauthorized use of the plates. Earlier Thursday, a vehicle with a Senate protocol plate sped off after being apprehended for misusing the EDSA busway. Authorities are still investigating if a senator was on board. Marcos also issued an order prohibiting government officials and personnel from using sirens, blinkers, and other signaling or flashing devices. The chief executive noted the indiscriminate use of such devices have caused traffic disruptions and unsafe road conditions. Some exemptions to the order are the armed forces, the National Bureau of Investigation, the police, and emergency vehicles.
The president's sister, Philippine Senator Aimee Marcos, rejects his order banning government use of signaling devices. Marcos says the use of the devices should be heavily regulated instead of being banned outright. She argued there are valid uses for the equipment. Other senators, meanwhile, welcome the president's order. Senate Majority Leader Joel Villanueva says public officials have the responsibility to set an example, especially when it comes to road discipline. Senator Grace Paul says government leaders must lead the way in shunning abuse and self-entitlement on the road. Senator J.V. Ejercito echoed the sentiment, noting government use of sirens and blinkers seems to have become a recent trend.
Transport groups set to hold another series of protests against a controversial PUV modernization program. The protests will begin Monday until April 30, which is the deadline for the mandatory franchise consolidation set by the government. President Marcos earlier said there will be no more extensions to this deadline. Manibela's Mar Valbuena now calling for the president's resignation for allegedly failing to respond to the needs of jeepney drivers. Under the PUV modernization program, operators must purchase new, air-conditioned, modern jeepneys as part of efforts to improve the public transport system.
The Philippine Navy investigating Thursday's crash in Cavite that killed two of its pilots. The victims were conducting a training flight but were forced to make an emergency landing for some unknown reason, resulting in the crash. The two were rushed to the hospital but succumbed to their injuries. The Navy expressing condolences to the victims' families.
The city of Manila will implement a tiered warning system to warn the public against extreme heat. Mayor Honey Lacuna says the Philippine capital city will adopt the current heat index classifications similar to the storm signal warning system for typhoons. She adds Metro Manila mayors are currently discussing whether they will adopt a system region-wide and what standards they should follow. That move comes after a Philippine lawmaker proposed implementing a storm signal-like warning system for extreme heat.
We're adopting the existing effect-based classification by PAGASA. We are adopting it right now. So it all starts with the different classifications like the heat index, like the one we have when there are typhoons. We are in the process, of course. There are recommendations coming from the local government, but these are things that they have to consider. We do not want any business to be disrupted in the city of Manila. We should also note that the heat index actually is computed by temperature and humidity, which is done indoors. So it is totally different from the actual heat being experienced outdoors.
Let's now check on the weather here in the Philippines with PAGASA forecaster Chanel Dominguez. Chanel?
Good afternoon, Denise, and good afternoon to everyone. We are currently not monitoring any tropical cyclone or low-pressure area within and outside our Philippine area of responsibility. However, easterlies continue to affect our country. Expect a warm and humid weather with chances of isolated rain showers and thunderstorms all over our country tomorrow. Expect it to persist in the next coming 3 days. The temperature range in here in Metro Manila is 25-35 degrees Celsius. And that's the latest here in PAGASA Weather Forecasting Center. Chanel Dominguez, and good afternoon.
Thanks, Chanel.
Up next, U.S. inflation accelerates in March.
And we'll be learning more about prostate cancer in our Health Talk segment. More news when we return. Published on medical journal The Lancet warns the number of new prostate cancer cases around the world will more than double over the next 2 decades. Findings of the study suggest the number of new cases annually will rise from 1.4 million in 2020 to 2.9 by 2040. To help us understand the disease better, we are joined by urologist and prostate surgeon Dr. Drew Valdez. Dr. Valdez, thank you so much for joining us here at Top Story.
Hello, thank you very much for inviting me. Yeah.
Now, Doc, tell us more about this. I mean, in the report, it said that the rise in prostate cancer, it really mentioned an aging population, the cause of this. You know, how does this demographic shift affect prostate cancer diagnosis?
All right. So prostate cancer is mainly a disease of the elderly, mainly because we don't really advocate screening of the general population due to a principle that if we detect a large number of patients with low risk or indolent cancers, there may be a risk for overtreatment. That's why most cases are diagnosed later on in life. And in our setting, the sad news is that we really diagnose them on a late stage. There are patients that we catch them early on, but most cases are either intermediate or in the high risk stage already. So this report says that it will increase in 20 years or so, meaning that they're now questioning, there's a question now if the current protocols and current protocols on treatment and diagnosis of prostate cancer is up to date. And then they're looking now into addressing these nuances in the near future so that we would be able to detect prostate cancer early on and on an early stage without still having the risk of over-treating indolent prostate cancers.
And, you know, we don't want that over-treatment. I mean, compared to other countries, are there any unique challenges that the Philippines faces in terms of prostate cancer screening and treatment?
In the Philippines, there's a mix of public and private healthcare facilities, and major cities have facilities in diagnosing prostate cancer, and they have the more advanced equipment and like MRI in diagnosing prostate cancer. But the good thing is, prostate cancer can be diagnosed with a physical examination, just a basic digital rectal examination, history, and taking prostate-specific antigen, a specific test for prostate cancer, and just general screening of a certain population, especially for populations who are at risk. If patients who have a family history of prostate cancer, especially in patients who have a brother or a father who had or has prostate cancer, especially if the patient, if their family members died of prostate cancer. So in the Philippines, yes, I trained in a government hospital, and many patients still consult, and we still detect lots of prostate cancers. Thanks to these institutions, large institutions, we are able to screen a large number of people who are at risk. And maybe in the outskirts of our country, and maybe the, with people who has less access to healthcare, maybe there are some problems with detection in certain regions in our country.
Are there any specific risk factors for prostate cancer that Filipinos should be aware of?
Prostate cancer really is, you can't really detect it until you have proper screening. But for risk factors, that's why there's no guaranteed way to prevent prostate cancer, especially if you have a strong family history of prostate cancer. But there are some strategies to reduce the risk of prostate cancer. It's the usual keep on being healthy. So consume a healthy diet, maintain a healthy weight, regular exercise, don't smoke, limit alcohol consumption, or do not consume alcohol, and participate in screening, especially if you are at risk of prostate cancer or you're 4 years old and above. At least you can have a annual examination with your urologist, where he or she can perform digital rectal examination and blood examinations that will monitor you, especially if you're at risk.
Dr. Valdez, what are some of the biggest misconceptions about prostate cancer that you encounter in your practice?
All right. So most common is that once you have an enlarged prostate, that you already have prostate cancer. Also, if you have an increased prostate-specific antigen level, PSA, you already have prostate cancer. And benign prostate enlargement versus prostate cancer, they're two different entities. And benign prostate cancer is in the name, it's benign, and they have different treatment approaches. For benign prostate enlargement, you just have to remove the prostate, the transitional zone that obstructs the urinary tract. But prostate cancer requires screening, and you need prostate-specific antigen testing and bone scans as necessary. And another misconception is that when you have an increased PSA, you already have prostate cancer. There are lots of other causes of increase in prostate-specific antigens, such as prostatitis, sexually transmitted infection, instrumentation, manipulation, and that may be causing the increase in PSA. So that's why we in social media we post infographics in these in our platform, so that we can help people, men, to understand that it's not all bad when you get an enlarged prostate or increase in PSA.
Dr. Duru Valdez, urologist and kidney stones and prostate surgeon. Dr. Duru, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much.
Inflation in the U.S. rose faster than expected in March. Consumer prices in the country rose 3.5% for the year to March, with higher costs for fuel, housing, and food driving the increase. Analysts had expected a 3.4% rise. They now warn the lack of progress in curbing price rises may force the U.S. central bank to keep interest rates higher for longer. The Fed was widely expected to cut rates in June. President Joe Biden says the unexpected jump in inflation could delay the Fed's plan to cut rates.
Well, I do stand by my prediction that before the year is out, there'll be a rate cut. This may delay it a month or so. But look, we have dramatically reduced inflation from 9% down to close to 3%. We're in a situation where we're better situated than we were when we took office, where inflation was skyrocketing. And we have a plan to deal with it.
BMI, a unit of Fitch Solutions, sticking to its forecast for 75 basis points of rate cuts by the Philippine Central Bank to still materialize in the second half of this year. This despite sticky inflation and bets the U.S. Federal Reserve will likely start cutting later and less. The BSP left its benchmark policy rate unchanged at a near 17-year high of 6.5%. The Banco Central also signaled a possible rate cut delay. BMI notes the recent uptick is due to upside surprises in food prices and will prompt the BSP to stand pat again on May 16 or until inflation is more firmly anchored within its target 2 to 4%. It adds sustained resilience in the economy and weakness in the peso will also mean the BSP will be in no hurry to loosen monetary policy and instead continue taking cues from the Fed and cut rates only when they do so.
More Filipinos had jobs in the second month of the year. The Philippine Statistics Bureau reports the jobless rate fell to 3.5% in February, translating to 1.8 million Filipinos out of work. The PSA says the underemployment rate in that month was the second lowest since 2005. This is lower than what was recorded in January and last year's 4.8%. According to the PSA, there were also fewer Filipinos looking for extra working hours in February. The underemployment rate came in at 12.4%. Manila's top economist, NEDA Secretary Arsenio Balisacan, says the Marcos administration remains committed to attracting more job-generating investments. Philippine investors pull back at the resumption of trading Thursday as they digest the latest jobs print and a lower economic growth forecast. Michelle Ong reports.
Stock markets dropped across Asia, led by Hong Kong and Australia, mirroring Wall Street's overnight move as hotter-than-expected inflation print for March reinforced the view the Fed will keep rates higher for longer. Here at home, local traders also digested a slew of data points. On the plus side, unemployment and underemployment both eased in February. While on the downside, ADB's Asian Development Outlook for April 2024 downgraded its GDP forecast for the Philippines this year to 6% from the previous estimate of 6.2%.
We have so much informality, even among wage earners. Being employed doesn't mean being gainfully employed. Government, since the end of last year, has been talking about supposedly the lowest unemployment rate since about 2005. I think at the same time, they should accept that even the Banco Central, the number of families without savings has increased actually by 600,000 in 2023. Over 19 million families don't have savings. Self-rated poverty surveys, private, more frequent than the government, has noted an increase in the number of poor and borderline poor Filipinos to, I think, as of last count, about 22 million. So basically, at the end of last year, when the government was saying that unemployment is the best in about 20 years since 2005, the number of families without savings, the number of families self-declaring themselves as poor or borderline poor has increased to about 7 to 8 of Filipino families. Even in Metro Manila, which has the highest minimum wage across the regions, you can't even have two minimum wage earners and reach the family living wage. I mean, that's it's a It's a problem not just in Metro Manila. I think it's much more problematic in the regions. Like I said, the 610 pesos minimum wage is the highest in Metro Manila. The average minimum wage is only 440 pesos, but the average family living wage is about 1,207 pesos across 17 regions. So like you mentioned earlier, that wage gap of about 762 pesos, that's felt most keenly in outside Metro Manila.
For the day, the PSE index tumbled back to the 6,600 level, down 1%, as net foreign selling hit a quarter of a billion.
Don't panic. I think we're still good. So far, the technicals are holding up, the fundamentals are holding up. This is likely just a knee-jerk reaction. And again, it's quite overdone in my opinion. So I'm still a buy on dips kind of guy, and I think this is the dip that we're talking about. So. Just a bit more cautious trading, but still be optimistic for the rest of the year.
Market will certainly react to the number from and will continue to monitor risks to the inflation outlook locally, given that the worries that El Nino and geopolitics will continue to exert price pressures on key commodities like rice and oil and delay the anticipated rate cuts from central banks. We recently raised our base case and 2024 PSEI target to 7,300 from 7,000 previously, as we recalibrated our 2024 earnings growth estimate to 10.5% from 9.1%.
In corporate stories, Mondanisin posts record consolidated revenue for the full year 2023, growing 9% to 80.2 billion pesos, driven by broad-based APAC branded food and beverage volume growth, which offset the softness in the meat alternative business under the Corn Foods brand. In all, core net income attributable to shareholders of parent hit 7.6 billion. However, if you include one-offs, reported net loss for the full year was at 625 million, mainly due to a non-cash, non-operating impairment of assets in the meat alternative business. Meanwhile, the company behind Lucky Me Noodles and Sky Flakes will be reallocating unused IPO proceeds of around 229 million pesos to CapEx this year for its APAC branded food and beverage business. Still in earnings, Balay ni Frutas, which is behind Balay Pandesal, Buko ni Frutas, and Frutas House of Desserts, reports a 58% jump in 2023 net income to 59 million pesos as revenue jumped just as much to over half a billion pesos. The company says Balay outperformed all other food service firms listed on the Philippine Stock Exchange in terms of both revenue growth and net income margin for 2023, despite inflationary pressure. How? Through limited price increase and a shift in product mix towards higher margin products. It also notes improved foot traffic, store network expansion, repeat customers, and the introduction of new products on the menu. In other news, integrated microelectronics subsidiary Via Optronics AG, a leading supplier of interactive display solutions, plans to voluntarily delist its American depository shares from the New York Stock Exchange. Via believes delisting ADSs from the U.S. public markets will be more economical, taking into account the low liquidity of its ADSs and the high cost of maintaining the New York Stock Exchange listing and U.S. SEC registration on an annual basis. It adds, delisting will also spare it from U.S. SEC reporting obligations and will allow the company to allocate resources more efficiently to execute its current business strategy by enabling its management and employees to focus more on managing its businesses and strengthening relationships. It anticipates that the last day of trading of the ADSs on the New York Stock Exchange will be on or about April 29 this year. And finally, Sun Life Philippines, still the number one life insurance company for 13 consecutive years after garnering 55.8 billion pesos in total premium income in 2023. The 129-year-old insurance company also ranks number one in terms of total assets at 306 billion pesos and net income at 8.8 billion. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippines' trade deficit narrows in February as exports pick up pace. The country's trade shortfall came in at $3.65 billion. That's down by 6% from 2023. The figure follows an improvement in total external trade in goods at $15.46 billion. Exports amounted to $6 billion, with electronic products accounting for most of the outbound shipments. The U.S. was the largest export market of the Philippines, followed by Japan and Hong Kong. Imports were also higher at $9.55 billion. China was the biggest source of inbound shipments, followed by Japan and South Korea.
The Philippine Tax Bureau's collection grew by more than 24% in the first 2 months of the year. The BIR says it was able to collect over 446 billion pesos in taxes in the January to February period. The BIR also reminds taxpayers they only have 5 days left before the deadline to file their annual income tax returns. The agency reminds the public the filing of tax returns for 2023 should be done electronically through EBIR forms downloadable through the BIR website. Manual filing will only be allowed for certain taxpayers such as senior citizens and persons with disabilities. The BIR aims to collect around 3 trillion pesos in taxes this year.
Over the past few weeks, there has been a surge in viral deepfake videos featuring prominent TV personalities, raising the question of whom or what we should trust online. In this report by Andrea Taguines, an AI expert provides insights into identifying signs of video manipulation.
Magandang morning, Doc, Michelle, and welcome to Sakto. Trinay ko yung hormone balance and it's actually doing great sa akin kasi nawala yung hot flashes. Nawala yung
Kapamilya host Ami Perez joins a string of Filipino TV personalities that have been used for deep fakes or videos manipulated with the use of artificial intelligence or AI. In a sponsored post on Facebook, Perez is made to appear as if she's endorsing a drug for women dealing with menopause.
Nag-appear siya sa feed ng isang kaibigan ko. Pinadala niya yung link sa akin. Tapos sabi niya, Mars, ikaw ba to? Talaga ako pinakinggan ko. Ay, parang boses ko talaga. Ang galing, di ba? Pero sobrang nakakatakot.
The video used was a real interview from Perez's previous morning show on DZMM Teleradio, but was edited towards the end. Perez asserts neither she nor the doctor she spoke with had mentioned any product during their whole exchange. The said drug, called Hormobalance, is not actually registered with the Food and Drug Administration. That's why Perez warns her followers against buying it.
Hindi ko tinetake yung gamot na yon ever. Ang nakakalungkot doon, ang daming babaeng nag-comment na puro tinatanong nila magkano yung produkto.
An AI expert points out the splicing of the video is one of the telltale signs that it's fake. There are also parts where the movements of the speaker's lips are not in sync with the audio track.
Parang siyang dinub. In fact, that was where this technology started for dubbing purposes to make the dubbed videos more natural.
According to Ligot, there are also times when scammers just loop one clip over and over.
Parang paulit-ulit yung ulo niya in the same direction. That's another known tactic. Kunyari, yung video clip mo is only 3 seconds, pero yung audio clip mo is maybe half a minute. Paulit-ulit lang yung galaw.
Filipinos can also catch deep fakes by listening for weird pronunciation of words or intonation.
Kunyari, pesos becomes pesos kasi nga these technologies were developed in English.
But as AI technology evolves, Ligot said it will only get harder to distinguish edited videos from real ones. His advice,
kailangan kinikilatis mo, ano bang narinig ko? Totoo ba yan? And we have to adopt yung mas skeptical na attitude. Usually yung mga common parang ano dyan eh, mga common uses dyan. Either it's a political message or may binibenta, like hard selling. You should automatically parang ano, scrutinize.
Ligot also encouraged the public to report such videos to social media sites, to authorities, and to the person being impersonated. And instead of believing online ads, the Department of Health said it's always better to consult with a doctor for their medical concerns. In a statement, DOH Secretary Ted Herbosa said his agency will continue to file cases against online pages making use of the DOH and FDA logos to trick people.
Wala po kaming ini-endorso kahit ni isang produkto, kahit gamot, kahit pagkain, wala po. So ibig sabihin, pag may nakita po kayo na nagsasabing DOH endorses this, dun pa lang ho, huwag na kayo maniwala.
Just recently, the videos of some ABS-CBN journalists and anchors were also manipulated to look like they were endorsing a slimming treatment. Andrea Taguines, ABS-CBN News.
Magandang morning, Ms. Amy.
More to come, Israeli airstrikes kill relatives of the leader of Hamas. Stay with us.
Your bank on top story. Militant group Hamas is closest to negotiators. It's unable to produce 40 hostages needed for a possible truce with Israel. That report from CNN Thursday, citing an Israeli official and a source familiar with the discussions. The development is raising fears more hostages may have died under Hamas captivity than publicly known. Hamas has reportedly told negotiators it could not identify nor track the 40 hostages, which include women, the sick, and the elderly. A framework for a six-week truce requires that Hamas release the hostages in exchange for Israel freeing 100 Palestinian prisoners. No word yet from Israel on the new information.
Three sons of Hamas leader Ismail Haniyeh killed in an Israeli airstrike in the Gaza Strip Wednesday. The Israeli military confirms carrying out the attack, describing the three sons as operatives in the Hamas armed wing. Israel, however, says it has no information on reports. Four of Haniyeh's grandchildren were also killed in the strike. Relatives say the three sons and four grandchildren were visiting family during the Muslim Eid al-Fitr holiday.
South Korea's Liberal Opposition Party scored a landslide victory in the country's parliamentary election, dealing a resounding blow to ruling conservatives. The Democratic Party is projected to take more than 170 of the 300 seats in the legislature, while a splinter Liberal Party is expected to take at least 10 seats. The allies, though, are likely to fall just short of a supermajority. The bitterly fought race was seen as a referendum on President Yoon Suk-yeol, whose popularity has suffered amid a cost-of-living crisis and a spate of political scandals. The National Election Commission is expected to announce the results later today.
Switching gears now, a Filipino-American nonprofit makes its colorful debut in Washington State as it hopes to introduce Filipino culture to mainstream America. Our North American correspondent, Bev Lorente, tells us more.
Vibrant colors showcasing Filipino fashion illuminated this room in Linwood, Washington. As Colors in Bloom, a new Filipino-American nonprofit organization, made its debut to the public.
That's the advocacy of Colors in Bloom. It's uplifting our culture, bringing awareness in the form of beauty, especially beauty pageants, in arts, culture, sports. So we are also kind of reminding everyone, like, our nieces are national sports, so we're going to be implementing events in relation to that.
Washington Filipinos welcome this new organization as an opportunity to further introduce Filipino culture to mainstream America.
I think it's so amazing that another one of our leaders gets to put together another nonprofit organization for the benefit of the community, whether that's locally or internationally, because more people should just take on this platform to make a difference.
You always feel warm, wonderful, and welcome in this community. So that's what it feels like to me all the time.
Seattle film designer Sachil Wilmot's traditional and modern Filipiniana design showcased at the fashion show, with each creation reflecting the intricate craftsmanship and vibrant hues of Filipino culture. From this embroidered Barong Tagalog to this delicate terno, the creations left the audience in awe. Film Beauty Queens and Miss Philippines Washington 2024, Isabel De Leon, were among the models. Their presence meant a lot to young Filipino women in the community, who regard them as an inspiration.
It's a big honor and a big responsibility. I owe it to them that I will be able to deliver, you know, a good show.
Amidst the applause and cheers, the launch of Colors in Bloom was formally announced, symbolizing a new chapter in the Filipino-American community's journey, with a focus on celebrating Filipino culture and fostering unity. Colors in Bloom aims to serve as a platform for collaboration, empowerment, and cultural preservation. Bev Lorente, ABS-CBN News, Linwood, Washington.
Sports news now. A Phil-Am team gymnast is hoping to secure a spot in the Paris Olympics with a stellar performance at next week's World Cup. Steve Angeles has the details.
Fresh from three competitions representing the Philippines, 17-year-old Los Angeles-born Olympic hopeful Levi Jung Ruvivar is hoping her performance on the bars at next week's World Cup in Doha, Qatar, can raise the bar when it comes to Philippine gymnastics.
I'm excited about the rest of the season. I'm really hopeful that I'll get to qualify to the Olympics. If I don't get that spot in Doha, there's also another opportunity for me to qualify during Asian Championships.
When she first picked up the sport at 2 years old and began excelling, the Ruvivar family knew that representing the Philippines was a strong possibility. After training in the U.S. system her whole life, and after signing to Stanford University for this fall, the Filipina team joined the Philippine team last year.
I just always had a really strong affinity for the Philippines, and I guess it was just something I kind of had my heart set on. We always talked about it as a family, and I just felt like it felt right in my heart, and I just felt that I wanted to be surrounded by the Filipino community.
The Ruvivar family is no stranger to the spotlight. Levi's grandfather is none other than the late Tony Ruvivar, founding member of the iconic band The Society of Seven. Her father, Anthony, is a Hollywood actor starring on the early 2000s hit Third Watch, recently appearing in the Disney Plus adaptation of Turner and Hooch. He's now working on NCIS Hawaii.
It was definitely something that we were always, it was always in the back of our minds. And, I don't know, I guess it was just more accessible, Levi's Filipino roots, through me, through the Society of Seven, my dad and the whole community. It was just a big, it was always just a big community that, Levi was raised in. And I think that maybe tipped the scales a little bit.
The Ruvivar family is looking beyond Levi's Olympic dreams. The sport can be costly, so along with other families, they set up the nonprofit Gymnastica to help support Filipino-American gymnasts.
Our hope was to try to help, subsidize some of those costs for the Phil-Am athletes and help them in that way. And at the same time, also, start to look forward to really kind of getting behind the fact that, the Philippines hasn't sent a women's gymnastics team to the Olympics. And so, our hope is that we change that.
Ruvivar isn't the only Filipino-American looking for a spot in the Olympics. Current UCLA junior Emma Malabio is also in the running to represent the Philippines at the Paris Games this summer. 2020 Olympian Carlos Yulo and Phil-Am Alea Finnegan-Cruz have already qualified for the Paris Games.
It would mean so much to make the Olympics and just win some medals for the Philippines and get a raise a Filipino flag. It would be amazing, and it also would mean a lot to inspire future generations of Filipino athletes in gymnastics, because that is one of the goals of Gymnastica as well, is we're trying to really help build the program and do anything that we can to get as many people involved as possible.
Ruvivar, who's currently training in Texas, will be heading for Doha later this week, where she will practice leading to the bars competition on April 17th and the floor on April 18th. The finals are set for Friday, April 19th. Steve Angeles, ABS-CBN News.
And before we go, Sydney is still reviewing its policy against allowing pets on public transport. So the appearance of this four-legged commuter must have come as a surprise. An escaped horse ran loose at a Sydney train platform last Friday, surprising fellow passengers. Transportation officials say train drivers were warned of the danger and told to slow down around the station. The animal was eventually captured and loaded on a trailer, and authorities confirmed the horse managed to return home safely. And those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Dinsai. You can watch highlights and recaps of our shows online on ANC 24/7 on Facebook and YouTube.
I'm Ron Cruz. You can also subscribe to ANC Prestige to our full lineup of shows. Thank you for watching.